voice debate about paying the rent. Yet while this debate continues, actual rents rose a massive 24%, driven mostly by overseas immigration. So it's like, yeah, conservatives, like, we don't want to pay the rent to Aboriginals, but you're paying the rent to all these Chinese property investors that are coming in, buying up all the property here, and all the Indians are now competing with you to rent those properties, all these new Indian student visa people. And so now your rents are now 25% more expensive. So, you know, conservatives, they want to rally against paying Aboriginals, but you're paying Indians, you're paying Chinese and so on. So, you know, why aren't you fighting against immigration? And that's the other thing. When we talked about the issues that Australians care about, no one cares about the voice, but people care about cost of living. They care about the housing crisis. This is driven by immigration. I talk all the time about how immigration is depressing Australian wages, and it's by design, and how it's massively the number one root cause. As Leith Van Onselen from Macro Business says, immigration is the everything issue. Economically, it is a total disaster for everyone's quality of life, whether it be the fact that you're sitting in traffic longer, infrastructure is failing, the environment is degrading, you're getting paid less to do the same work. Now you've got a bunch of, you have to work with a bunch of non-whites who don't have the same standards and kind of culture as you. And so you're alienated at your own job. Meanwhile, everything's getting more expensive, particularly your housing. And then at the same time, the government is telling you this nonsense that they want to get net zero carbon emissions. But they're stuffing the country full of another 14 million people over the next, you know, 3 or 4 decades. How are we supposed to have no carbon emissions if you keep bringing in more people that are going to keep using even more electricity? I mean, if you really care about the environment, then you would stop immediately bringing anyone else here, because you're just putting even more and more strain and stress on the environment. I mean, everything, whether it be water usage, energy usage, having to not chop down more trees to build more houses and pave more roads and so on. There's more rubbish that needs to go to the tip. Like, on every dimension, there's just more economic, environmental impact from stuffing the country full of more Pajits.
I'll tell you what's probably the most anti-environmental perspective that you could have, that everybody on the surface of the earth right now deserves to live a first world lifestyle, a lifestyle which is the result of the civilizations established by white people in the world. If you honestly believe that that's sustainable, possible, that's not going to result in just crazy amounts of pollution and burning unnecessarily large amounts of fossil fuels. Look, I don't even know if burning fossil fuels is bad for the environment or not, because I'm not actually an environmentalist and I haven't looked into it. But think about it. This whole egalitarian concept operates on the basis that everyone, every Indian, every African, the billions and billions of people in all the different races in the world who haven't developed at the same rate and who aren't capable of the same culture, who all have different levels of IQ, they all deserve to live a first world lifestyle first established by and upheld by white people, right? So what, they're all going to be living in the same houses, they're all going to be producing the same waste, like Joel's saying, right? Like, there's probably nothing that's more anti-environmental than that. You can't claim to care about the earth and also think that every immigrant deserves a first world lifestyle, right? It's kind of,
we're not going to be able to sustain it. I mean, if you break, like, we're already losing our first world lifestyle as we speak because of the economic effects of all of this. The wages to cost of living ratio keeps going down and down. We're rapidly losing the status of a first world country. I mean, as I said, the average income earner in Australia can't afford to buy a house in anywhere in Sydney except the two shittiest suburbs in Sydney. And I don't mean I mean service a mortgage on a house. That's how fucked the economy is. And this is just the beginning. It's only going to get worse. If all of these policies continue for the foreseeable, it's only going to get worse and worse and worse as time goes on.
I hope we don't have to like watch it all fall apart and then be the ones who stand there with our arms crossed saying, I told you so. I hope that we can do something to turn this around. I hope we can make a difference and actually carve out a piece of Australia for ourselves, or at least contribute to the process reversing somehow. You know, I don't want to be the guy who just watches this country burn and then gets to say, I told you so. You know, it's not good enough for me.
Yeah, so you know, we keep getting told that immigration is so great for the economy and so on. Now, 72% of migrants that come to Australia aren't selected based upon their skills. So these migrants are brought in to address so-called skill shortages, we're told, but 72% of them aren't actually don't have any skills. So this is apparently great for our economy. No, it's not. It's terrible for the economy. But he says here, again, he kind of talks about how immigrants enroll to vote. 20% more of them will vote Labor than native population, boasted a Labor-aligned consultant. We talk about that all the time. According to research done by the Carnegie Endowment, newly arrived migrants are more than twice as likely to vote Labor as they are the coalition. And yet the coalition is blindly supportive of mass immigration, walking themselves into a political death trap. And, you know, this is the reality that we're dealing with in Australia. We don't have one nation is not doing its job. I mean, in Germany, you've got the Alternative for Deutschland. In Sweden, you have the Sweden Democrats. In Austria, you have the Freedom Party. These parties are all polling over 20% in all three of these countries. And they're all the anti-immigration party, basically. So the idea that a Western country can't have a right-wing populist party that does well, that's pushing hard against immigration, is false. We can see in roughly similar countries that very dynamic. But there's just a total lack of political leadership.
You can do it. You just have to get used to having your bank accounts closed, having your personal residence terrorized or vandalized, and just generally being treated like a terrorist. I'm sure many of the representatives for Alternative for Deutschland have experienced treatment like this. And I'm sure people who rise up as champions of their own nation, of their own ethnic existence, continued ethnic existence in this world, white people, they're going to be treated like terrorists as well. But that's just something you're going to have to endure, right? It'll make you harder. It will make you sharper. Yeah. They won't kill you. Put it that way. They won't kill you. They'll do everything else except kill you. They'll try to get you in jail. But, you know, you got to make it as hard for them as you can.
Yeah, no, of course. The politics is a dirty game. They're not just going to let us have it. You know, you're going to have to, when you go up against the system takes shots at you and you're going to have to weather those shots. That's just the reality of politics. There's no easy way. It doesn't matter how optical you are, how strategic you are. There's no way to avoid getting punched in the face by the system when you're trying to oppose it. That's power politics. That's how it works.
Man, I wish the system did punch you in the face, but it kind of like stabs you in the back while you're trying to sleep. Stuff like that. Like that's the way the system kind of creeps up on you. So like, anyway,
I want to play this clip.
Yeah. Okay.